You know, growing up in the church, one of the things growing up in the church was it was real easy to just try to avoid those people. To live in Christian world and to keep from coming into contact with those people. Because what would people think in church if I brought a friend who was coming out of the homosexual lifestyle? What would they think about that? What would the people in church, how would they treat them? How would they treat, if I brought a girl to church who was known as a party girl, how would they treat her, and then how would they respond to me? What are you doing hanging around her? And unconsciously, I believe that growing up in Christian world and in the church, I had gotten to this unconscious thing of, we don't want those people here. Because for most of us, church is to be a comfortable place. For most of us, church, we think, should be a safe place. And so we can't have those people coming into the church. Because if we have those people coming into the church, then they're going to mess it up. Because they don't understand how you're supposed to do church. They don't understand that you're supposed to dress this way. They don't understand you're not supposed to raise your hands. You're not supposed to clap. They don't understand the sitting and standing and sitting and standing things. They don't understand the things of church. So don't mess it up by bringing those people into the church, because you're going to mess it up. But at the same time, we have this thing that we call the Great Commission that Jesus gave, which is Acts 16:15, go preach the gospel to every creature. Matthew 28:19-20, go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So at the same time, we've got this commission that Jesus has given us, and he says, go to all the people. And that means that if I'm going to do what Jesus says, and that means I have to go to those people. I have to go and talk to the homosexuals. I have to go and talk to the fornicators and the adulterers and the effeminates and the swindlers. And I've got to go talk to those people. You see what the struggle is? Because a lot of times, especially if you've grown up in the church, we tend to develop a mindset that the church needs to be a safe and comfortable place. And yes, we know about the Great Commission, but I don't know if I want to do the Great Commission. Jesus hung out with the sinners. He had a reputation for hanging out with the sinners. And Jesus hung out with the tax collectors, considered as thieves by most people in those days, extortioners, swindlers. Jesus hung out with them. One of them was his disciple. Jesus hung out with the prostitutes. He went to the parties where there were going to be prostitutes there. He knew that. And it caused the people in the religious community to turn up their nose at Jesus, because how dare you, if you're really the Savior, the Son of God, you're not going to hang out with those kinds of people. Because we don't want those kinds of people in our synagogues. We don't want those kinds of people in our temples. And you know what? Paul did the same thing too. Paul preached to those people. Look at our text. 1 Corinthians 6:9. Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers, will inherit the kingdom of God. But look at verse 11. Such were some of you. But you were washed. But you were sanctified. But you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and in the Spirit of our God. I love verse 11. It's one of my favorite verses.
God. Paul is preaching to the church. And he's just gone through this laundry list. Idolaters, revilers, swindlers, fornicators, adulterers, homosexuals, effeminate. And he says, and such were some of you. When God looks at people, he sees two groups, the unrighteous and the righteous. The unrighteous people in verse 9 and 10 are clearly unbelievers. Paul says they will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, for you to inherit something, you have to belong to someone. Or certainly have a connection to that person. If my neighbor passes away, he's just not going to give me his house because I'm his neighbor. He's going to give his house to his children because there's a connection there. Or if he has no children, he or she's going to give it to somebody who is special to the family. And the reality is, the unrighteous, people who practice these things unrepentantly, habitually, who have no remorse, they are what Paul says are the unrighteous. There's one thing on this list that you would probably say is probably worse than any of these. It's sin of murder. Guess who's writing this book? Paul. What did Paul do? Persecuting that Christian's good. You know why Paul didn't have a problem going to those people? The adulterers, the effeminate, the homosexuals, the swindlers, the robbers. You know why it didn't faze him to go and talk to them? There is a key point I want you to get this. Here's what drove Paul. Grace receivers are grace givers. Grace receivers are grace givers. You see, Paul had received God's grace. God had saved him. And Paul, he went to the people who were hurting because he had received God's grace. I love verse 11. Look at it. Such were some of you. Look at yourself. Some of you, this is what you were. But you were washed. Paul's referring to what Titus 3:5, when he would later write in Titus 3:5, he saved us not by anything which we have done, but according to his mercy. God saved us by the washing of regeneration, by the renewing of the Holy Spirit. When Paul preached to his people in Corinth, he didn't see a church full of homosexuals and effeminates and adulterers and swindlers and revilers and those things. What he saw was a church of people who were washed. Paul says, yes.